Welcome to Tanzania.
This is a film about history and education in Tanzania.
We believe that education can help us to stop neo-colonialism in Tanzania.
It is the work of Mr. Gordon Fischer with his teachers and students in Tanzania.
Thank you, enjoy the film.
This is Africa, and this is Tanzania.
The art of documentary film turns life into a creative process where one is guided by a camera and a topic to study. For 3 summers while in college, I taught U.S. history to high school students. After seeing history as a powerful tool, a potentially revolutionary tool, I wanted to find out how history was taught in a post-colonial nation. I went to Tanzania in 2013 on a grant I received upon graduating from Colby College in Waterville, Maine. The word Tanzania comes from the unification of mainland Tanganyika with the islands of Zanzibar. I spent 7 months in Tanzania and 1 in Uganda, guided by intuition and friends who hosted me. Education is the most powerful weapon one can use to change the world. I went to the Tanzania Institute of Education to learn more about the ways history curriculum developers are thinking about the goals of history in this post-colonial African nation. Here I met Dorothy Kagura, a designer of the history curriculum for the country's public schools.
The past normally causes the present. That is the opening statement. We normally like to say that. We teach history because history normally gives an overview. We also want to develop an understanding of the relationship between African developmental problems. We see there are a lot of problems. Where are these problems emanated from? So we teach history so that our students can understand the relationship between Africa's developmental problems and, we say, foreign intrusion, colonial domination, cultural subjugation, and economic exploitation in various periods. After most of African countries got independence, they realized that, we are now independent. But the type of history we are teaching our students will not help them anyway. They may not even understand that they have a very big part to play.
What is African history?
Part of rewriting African history included giving Africans their proper place in the history of human evolution.
I want to know the origin of Mars.
During colonialism, history was taught differently. It was taught to promote European claims of their superiority over Africans, to undermine the African self-respect and self-awareness. Also, to perpetuate European claims to be a civilizing mission in Africa. But Africans had their own civilization. We know that.
A friend connected me to Isotho John, a Maasai who studies history in Uganda, but is from Monduli, Tanzania. Isotho invited me to his village, and I stayed for 7 weeks. While I was there, I visited a secondary school called Orkeswa. One night, Isotho filmed while his father told me about pre-colonial African history.
Kutokana na sisi wa Afrika kabla ya wakoloni kuja, sisi tulikuwa tunapata mafunzo kutokea kwa wazee mababu wetu.
Before entering high school, students must pass Form 1 through 4. After learning about the history of human origins in Africa in Form 1, students go on to learn about pre-colonial African societies and the slave trade in Form 2. In Form 3 and 4, students learn about the history of colonialism.
Colonialism is something that is past now, so we can study about it and find ways, we find the reasons why it happened, then we find ways of moving from it so it can liberate us in the future.
I visited secondary schools across Tanzania to sit in on history classes that covered topics related to colonialism and its legacies.
What is colonialism?
Colonialism is the process whereby the superior powers, mainly of European origin, dominate the inferior nation in all aspects of life, like economically, socially, politically, and culturally.
Ask yourself, why colonization of Africa?
One day, while roaming the streets of Dar es Salaam, I came upon a school called Masak Secondary, where students were preparing for their Form 4 exam. I conversed with many of them about the themes of history, colonialism, and capitalism. I spoke with the Dean of History at a university in Uganda, and with the students at Masak about how changes in European capitalism led to the colonization of Africa.
Africans is the continent who have many precious minerals and other many natural resources. So my question, why the capitalist nations are developed more than Africans and the resources they took them from Africans?
If you look at the issue of capitalism, the issue of expansion came in because of numerous issues like the economic changes in Europe because of the Industrial Revolution.
For many reasons of Industrial Revolution in Europe during the 19th century, there was a demand of raw materials. So they came in Africa to search raw materials in order to feed their industries in Europe.
But I think colonialism is not just a new phenomenon, because if you look at the establishment of the Roman Empire, it was a form of colonialism. The idea of putting other people under someone's control has been an old age thing. It's not something that just came up out of the what? Of the blue. Actually, before colonialism, there was imperialism. Because imperialism, you are expanding, you are controlling, you are dominating. So colonialism is like the establishment of imperialism.
The continent of Africa, this one, I think you see it. Is that it? Yeah. So now, we are going to see another concept.
You see, what is Islam? You see, what is it? Islam. So what is Islam? The grass, what is Islam?
In 1884, German Chancellor Edward Otto von Bismarck convened the Berlin Conference, where seven European nations divided up the entire African continent.
The resolution of this, of Berlin Conference, come with the solution of the colonization of Africa.
The borders drawn in Germany in 1885 remain as the national borders for African countries today. How was colonial rule formally established?
Urafiki wenu amekuchukulia zawadi yenu.
Asante sana bwana mkubwa. Asante sana bwana mkubwa.
Dr. Karl Peters, come here again.
So,
Dr. Karl Jürgen. Mimi sijui kuandika.
Oh, dann machen wir so. Mit dem Fingerabdruck. So.
Du fährst mir. Ah,
Asante. Asante.
Besuch bwana mkubwa.
Burgers. Or sometimes known as what?
Treaties.
So, the treaties claimed to make a friendship. Actually, they claimed to make a friendship with these chiefs. But their objectives was to make sure that Africans are surrendered. I mean, African leaders are surrendered their independence and their powers to be under the control of the whites.
Many Africans resisted colonial rule, but European military might eventually quelled any unrest. The colonial regime then implemented a formalized system of economic exploitation. In 1919, at the Treaty of Versailles, Great Britain took over Germany's colonies and gained control of Tanganyika.
As we know the foreign rules, how it was, it was not good. It was for the interest of the whites. It was the interest
of the European people, not for the Africans.
What was education like under the colonial regime? At first, formal education was brought by missionaries. While Islamic schools had been on coastal Tanzania since the 7th century, Christian missionaries first appeared around the 1860s.
African culture and religion were labeled as primitive, uncivilized, ungodly. And then they were saying, if you open the book looking for Africa, Africa is a black continent.
History textbooks all spoke about the colonization of minds, a deliberate brainwashing of Africans by European curriculum designers during colonialism. I went to the education department at the University of Dar es Salaam, where I met Professor Ishumi and Professor Posi. We talked about the history of education in Tanzania and began with the topic of colonial education and the colonization of minds.
You've been ruled. You are expected to think the way the ruler thinks. That was a process of educating you in order to believe in the values and in the system of the colonial master. That is basically colonization of the mind. It is actually work, active work, on the mind of the individual.
Well, colonization of mind is there. I mean, it was there. Like when I was in standard 5, I can vividly remember that we were singing the national anthem of the colonialists. I still remember Salamu Mfalme Mkuu Mfalme wa Inchi Hii Ukitawala Juu Furaha Yako Juu. You know, it's like we were talking about the king and the queen in there, because they were our colonizers.
African university students are passionately debating this issue today.
They colonized us mentally. Whatever we think is white or whatever we think is foreign, it is good. You get it right? The education system, the what? We believe that whatever came from the colonial masters is good. And whatever is indigenous, whatever is African, is local and poor. You get it right? So that's what I can say, that that's the colonization of mind.
Obviously, we think that the idea was they didn't want to enlighten people. That's what was maybe a fear of people getting to know. If you talk about nationalism, if you talk about imperialism, if you talk about capitalism, people would begin to see the exploitation, and maybe they would begin reacting.
After several months of intensive research and discussion on the history of colonialism in Africa, I was invited to teach in some of the schools I had visited.
Colonialism appeared due to a series of developments within the capitalist world system.
The face you see on the shirt I wear is Mwalimu Julius Kambarage Nyerere, a history teacher who led Tanzania to independence and was president from 1962 to 1985. I visited the primary and secondary schools where Mwalimu studied, and I spoke with students and sat in history classes across the country to learn more about his legacy.
Mwalimu Julius Kambarage Nyerere is the greatest man in Africa, and he was a wise person. His wisdom will be not forgotten by anybody in this country.
So you cannot say anything about African history without mentioning the name of Mwalimu Julius Kambarage Nyerere. He holds the same place as African popular figures, just like Dr. Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana, Dr. Jomo Kenyatta of Kenya, Nelson Mandela of South Africa, and other prominent African figures He's a true son of Africa, a true black man.
Mwalimu Julius Kambarage Nyerere alizaliwa Butiama mwaka 1922 katika ukoo wa machifu huko Butiama.
Butiama is a Zulu word which means the rulers. So Mwalimu was born a leader.
Baada kumaliza elimu yake hiyo, kuna vitu ambavyo Nyerere alikuwa anavipenda au tuseme wasifu wake. Sawa? Wasifu?
By profession, Mwalimu Julius Kambarage Nyerere was a teacher. The word Mwalimu is a Swahili word which means a teacher.
While Mwalimu was teaching history, a movement for liberation was growing throughout the African continent.
African nationalism is a desire of the African people to be able to rule themselves, to have an ability to rule themselves, and to have a desire of terminating all the foreign rule.
Especially the first leader in these countries, especially African countries, they were so much engaged to look on the why we are here, why people are exploited, and how can we move this kind of miserable situation.
In 1954, Mwalimu resigned from teaching and founded a political party called Tanganyika African National Union. The main goal was to unite Tanganyikans in the struggle for independence. In an effort to bring together the disparate tribes of Tanganyika, TANU encouraged the use of Swahili, which remains as the national language today.
Remember, the large number of people in Tanzania are Bantus. That is why Nyerere used this language to unite the people, to organize the people.
In 1961, Tanzania was formally granted independence from Great Britain. There were high hopes that, in addition to freedom, independence would bring economic prosperity and self-determination. However, Tanganyikans soon realized that what they were granted was merely flag independence, inheriting a colonial state prepared for neo-colonial status.
Soon, the Union Jack would fly no more over Tanganyika. God Save the Queen would be replaced by God Bless Africa.
Haji! Julia!
Why do you call it flag independence? We were given independence. We look like as if we have the instruments of independence. We have the symbols, like the flag, we even have the anthems. But when you look at what is on the ground, we don't seem to be what? Independent.
In the 1960s, new African leaders met to discuss strategies for development. Pan-African philosophers dreamed of uniting Africa as a solution to the post-colonial forms of imperialism. In 1964, the majority African population overthrew the Sultan of Zanzibar, ending over 200 years of Arab colonization on the island. While African unity on a grand scale was never attained, this revolution created an opportunity for the island to unite with Tanganyika. To symbolize this union, Nyerere mixed sands from the two countries. Tanganyika and Zanzibar had merged to form Tanzania. After uniting, the challenge was to build a new nation.
right after independence, school fees were abolished. I remember when I got to secondary school, I had a free uniform, I had free textbooks, free everything. When I was in standard 6, then we got independence. Okay. So I could see the changes. We used to have Oxford readers in English. Then the books changed, then they were written now a little bit by the Africans.
History is a sense of identity because it gives you knowledge of where you came from, who you are right now, and then what you can even be.
A friend in college had given me a copy of Africa Must Unite by Kwame Nkrumah, the father of African nationalism and Ghana's first president. It was in this book where I first read about the problem of neo-colonialism. The line I remember most was that political independence is not economic independence.
And now all the African countries are independent. Is it right?
Yes.
But all of them are under this system now here. Neo-colonialism.
As I traveled and learned more about the history of Tanzania, I developed more questions about Nyerere's vision to combat neo-colonialism. At the University of Dar es Salaam, I conversed with sociology students about the idea of development. What is development? I learned that Nyerere's legacy as president included Ujamaa, his attempt at African socialism. I asked students and teachers in Tabora Secondary School about Ujamaa and Mwalimu's dream to create a socialist society in Tanzania.
As you know, Mwalimu was a philosopher. So on 5th of February 1967, Mwalimu slowly hit the party, made a declaration in the Arusha region, we call it Arusha Declaration, which declared the policy of Ujamaa and self-reliance. The word Ujamaa means brotherhood. With the Ujamaa policy, Mwalimu Nyerere established the individualization policy.
Tanzanians were encouraged to move into government-monitored Ujamaa villages, where they would receive social services such as schools and healthcare.
Through those Ujamaa villages, people can learn the importance of self-reliance and hard working.
In the 1970s, the Dodoma region had the highest number of Ujamaa villages. I wondered, what is there now? What is left of these villages? How do people remember Ujamaa? Does anyone still live in an Ujamaa village? Deep inside this village in Dodoma, I met people who remember the experience of Ujamaa.
Historia ya Ujamaa kwanza, walikuwa wanasema hiki kijiji kidogo hawawezi kuweka kijiji. Lakini mwenye kijiji alisisitizwa mpaka akakamilisha kikawa kijiji. Watu wa Matumburu, watu wa Mgoma, watu wa wapi, wote wakawa wanakuja hapa. Kuja hapa ndio wakaanza kutuhenyesha makazi huko.
This man was a former Ujamaa leader. He took us to the fields where he used to farm.
Ujamaa kweli kwa mzuri. Hakuwa na shida. Na ndio maana hata watu wakati wanaitikia tunakuja tunafanya kazi bila shida.
Sio wakuu, sio uzuri. Ulikuwa uzuri tu lakini sio sana. Kuja tu ulipita na sisi umetuacha. Hatukuona chochote.
What happened to Ujamaa? After an initial enthusiasm died down, the government stepped in 1973 and forcefully moved millions from their villages and into Ujamaa villages. Industries and banks were nationalized, and the sisal production became state-run. By 1979, Ujamaa villages contained 90% of the rural population, but produced only 5% of the national agricultural output. Nyerere's vision for economic self-reliance had backfired. Tanzania was one of the poorest and most foreign aid-dependent countries. I asked farmers I met about the legacy of Mwalimu and what they remember about Ujamaa today in Tanzania.
Kwa kweli maendeleo yalikuwa tunategemea sana maendeleo sana sana walio wengi kwa tunategemea kilimo kama sasa hivi unavyotuona tunalima tunategemea kilimo.
Economically, Mwalimu's policies had failed. But socially, he had unified a nation and created a sense of national identity.
Through adapting this Arusha Declaration and education for self-reliance as one of its pillars, he believed that he will fight new colonialism.
As a history teacher, Mwalimu knew and believed in the power of education. In addition to the steps immediately taken after independence, Nyerere published the Education for Self-Reliance essay as part of the Arusha Declaration in 1967. This essay is remembered throughout Africa as a staple of post-colonial educational policies.
When Nyerere was the president, he was trying to come up with a different educational system which he felt would suit the needs of the people of Tanzania.
The main reason was because Nyerere, during his study times, he observed how the colonial education was. It's only based on the European syllabus, it was just bookish, meaning that everything was learned in class only. There was nothing like practice. And he thought, because Tanzania is a very poor country, there was a need for people to know how to work.
Part of Mwalimu's belief was that Tanzanian education should combine modern schooling techniques with traditional forms of teaching and learning. What was pre-colonial education like in Tanzania?
Tanzania consisted of a number of ethnic groups. Each of these ethnic groups had some kind of education. That education was not conducted in a room like we have in a classroom, but we followed instructions that came from our elders, either with parent, father, or mother. And therefore, education was there from time immemorial.
Although the Education for Self-Reliance program is no longer in effect, I found that some rural schools still incorporate its principles today.
Ni kifupi cha neno elimu ya kujitegemea. Sasa elimu ya kujitegemea ni elimu ambayo inamwezesha mwanafunzi kujitegemea pale anapomaliza darasa la saba. Kwamba akimaliza darasa la saba, akitoka shuleni hata kama hajafaulu kwenda mbele, basi anaweza kujitegemea kwa namna moja ama nyingine ili kuweza kujipatia riziki yake.
Mwalimu said, independence means self-reliance. Independence cannot be real if a nation depends upon gifts and loans from another for its development. But despite efforts to become self-reliant, the Tanzanian economy remained dependent on agricultural exports that did not cover the cost of manufactured goods and machines being imported. In 1985, Mwalimu stepped down and Ali Hassan Mwinyi succeeded him as president. With the country mired in debt, Mwinyi soon accepted loans from the IMF and World Bank, ushering in a new form of colonial relations between Tanzania and the West. Access to the IMF and World Bank funds are tied to a set of conditionalities known as structural adjustment programs. Foreign companies have since earned 97% of the profits from the gold mining industry in Tanzania. History textbooks decry these structural adjustment programs as being the clearest example of neo-colonialism. Students at Buswelo Secondary School had a debate on whether or not poor economic development in Africa is caused by foreigners.
I'm going to talk about trade in the exchange of goods for money. And now, our country can have minerals, but are we going to use the minerals ourselves? We must sell them. And when we sell the minerals, we are just getting a small profit from our own natural resources.
There is a link between the current economic situation and the history of colonialism.
Through this structural adjustment program, it's the same as, if you remember, while the colonists, they were trying to colonize the Africa. They used what? One of the methods used is about what? Bogart treaties. It's the same applied nowadays. Our leaders, they signed the treaties of the country to remain with 7%. Why 97? Is it taken?
In history class, students can see connections between the past and the present as they build toward a brighter future.
Neocolonialism is just a remnant of colonialism. So we can have to trace how the colonialism started, how is it going on, and how it operates. And that will help us to remove the rare and unbearable circumstances such as that of neocolonialism.
As I traveled throughout Tanzania, it became evident that the country is still struggling to become truly independent.
Hello.